Welcome everybody to the ourgem speaker series. My name is Marie Schmidt. I work for the University of Idaho in Coeur d'Alene. I'm part of the ourgem collaborative. We're a group of water professionals working to preserve lake health through education and outreach. I'm also a part of a group called the Confluence Project. We are a group that teaches high school students about our watershed through hands-on experiences. We have a committee of several members, but today I have a few of them joining me. I have Jenny Gray. And Jenny, would you mind giving a brief intro of yourself?
Yeah, my name's Jenny Gray. I'm the Aquifer Protection Program Coordinator at Panhandle Health District. And I've been involved with the Confluence Project for about 2 years. Working primarily on the groundwater education portion, gone out on a couple of the snow science trips, and then working with the kids on developing their youth water science projects. So it's been a really, really fun project to be involved with and great group of people to work with.
Great. Thank you. Hi, I'm Rebecca Stevens with the Coeur d'Alene Tribe. I'm their Hazardous Waste Management Program Manager in the Lake Management Department, as well as their Restoration Coordinator. And I've been involved with the Confluence Project and Youth Water Summit for a few years now, and really enjoy working with these students. And I'm happy to be here to help Marie out today as we go through some of these presentations.
Our presentation today is on the Youth Water Summit. So this is a presentation from the Confluence Project. And again, it's our high school projects. So first of all, we have just a little intro from Governor Little, and I'll play this. And if you don't mind, just somebody chatting me if the sound isn't working, I believe it'll work.
Hi, I'm Governor Brad Little, and welcome to the 2021 Youth Water Summit. Your participation in the Confluence Project is helping you learn how to ask questions and investigate our natural world and explore science and engineering possibilities. Too many of us take clean, sustainable water for granted. This program uses STEM skills to measure and forecast risks to clean water. You are expanding your abilities and sharpening your skills so you can approach the world with solutions to problems. You are learning the skills necessary to become a competitive member of Idaho's workforce and a driving force in Idaho's robust economy. Water is truly the source of life. Protecting Idaho's waters and Coeur d'Alene Lake in particular will continue to be at the forefront of my priorities, and appreciate all for making it a priority too. Enjoy your time viewing this year's virtual Youth Water Summit. Thank you.
So we appreciate Governor Little's support of our
program. Hi.
Just very quickly, before we get into student videos, a little bit of background on the Confluence Project. So the Confluence Project, it's a high school watershed education program shaped around hands-on field experiences. We focus on surface water quality, groundwater, and snow science. We have all of the lessons are really place-based, so they're based in our watershed here locally and focused on hands-on activities. And then it culminates in the Youth Water Summit. Our program started in 2012, and it's gone through some different changes, but here's our current Confluence Project committee. So we have representatives from Kootenai Environmental Alliance, Beausoleil Environmental Consulting, Idaho Department of Environmental Quality, University of Idaho Extension, Panhandle Health District, the University of Idaho Coeur d'Alene, and the Coeur d'Alene Tribe. As I mentioned, our program is really focused on these hands-on field experiences. So the first one that we do in the fall is the water quality. We visit a local stream or lake and have the students take measurements of physical components, biological components, and habitat assessments. So they measure the water quality using little test kits to measure pH, dissolved oxygen, temperature, water clarity, water depth, things like that. They also look at aquatic macroinvertebrates, sometimes plankton, and then, as I said, also doing a habitat assessment. So looking at what else is going on in the area that might affect water quality. We also focus on groundwater. One of our primary sponsors of the program is the Aquifer Protection District. And so through their funding, we were able to add a pretty significant amount of groundwater curriculum to our lessons. And we were able to incorporate several different types of lessons for the students. Some are in the field, some are tours of municipal wells, some are in-class demonstrations, that type of thing. And then we also do snow science. We take the students up to Lookout Pass and we go snowshoeing with them. And then we dig pits in the snow and measure the snowpack. And they can compare their data that they collect to the national snowtell data that's collected all over the country and specifically at the site that we go to. So they can compare their data to the data that's being collected by experts. So those are just kind of that's just an overview of what the Confluence Project is. Again, we really focus on getting students out of the classroom and get these hands-on experiences. This year we had fewer schools than usual because of limitations with COVID. So we're looking forward to getting back to having our usual, which is about 10 to 12 schools each year. And we're looking forward to that this fall. I'm gonna pass it off to Rebecca.
Sure. You know, on behalf of the Confluence Project and Youth Water Summit Steering Committee, we really want to acknowledge how difficult this past year has been for all of us, but in particular for today's online ourgem series, the students and the teachers as they navigated virtual learning and limitations due to the limited in-school learning. The students that participated in this year's Youth Water Summit had to adjust to conducting their research projects in a very short time frame, like some just a 2-week time frame, plus the modification from an in-person poster presentation that would have normally been held at North Idaho College. With all of the judges' support, we couldn't do it without you. We want to express our gratitude to the following teachers that kept the ball rolling for these students as they created virtual videos for this year's Youth Water Summit. We had Jennifer Murray out of Wallace High School, Jamie Essler, Lake City High School in Coeur d'Alene, and Jared Forsyth out of Lakeland High School in Rathdrum. Thank you so much, teachers, and for all the students. We want to thank all of the students, not just those that you're going to see today, that developed research projects and had to learn ways of presenting their findings in video format. We understand it wasn't easy, and we just want to show our gratitude, of which we will do by providing prizes to the top winning students and teams from each school that were able to participate. So once again, on behalf of the committee, we want to thank you all and turning it back over to you, Marie. Thanks.
Thanks, Rebecca. Okay, so the way we do this is the students each create a water-related research project. Some work by themselves and some work in teams. And then they come up with their own research question and have to research it. And we do ask them to do some kind of hands-on research, data collection, whether that's interviewing or going out in the field and collecting data that way. We ask them to do something like that. This year, again, we're working on a very short timeframe, as Rebecca said. So you might see some limitations in the data that they actually collect. But then they recorded videos and we had volunteer judges from our community watch those videos and fill out a rubric and score them. And so these top projects are coming from those rubrics from judges in our community. So these were the top projects from Wallace High School. We had first place was Tegan Goldaid with mountain biking and erosion. Second place was Isaiah Jaramillo with metals in the Coeur d'Alene River, and third place was Brendan Hines with seaweed and fish populations. So we are actually going to show the first place winner from Wallace High School. So I'm going to start that video now.
Hello, I'm Tegan Goldaid. I attend Wallace Junior Senior High School, and this is my project, Mountain Bike Erosion, for the Youth Water Summit. First off, my question is, do mountain bike trails speed up the natural erosion process? My hypothesis, trails affect the erosion process, but not enough to impact the waterways dramatically. Moving on, why did I choose my topic? I decided to look into how mountain bike trails affect the environment simply because I enjoy mountain biking and dedicate hours and hours to either riding others' trails or making my own, and wanted to know my and others' impact on the surrounding ecosystem. Secondly, why is my topic important? First off, my topic is important to me because I love mountain biking, partially because you get to spend time out in nature. If it hurts the environment while doing it, it becomes counterproductive. I want to know how to leave the least impact possible. How is it important to my community? Silver Mountain brings thousands of travelers from across the nation to ride their trails and work up an appetite while doing so. What I'm getting at is it brings business to the community as a whole, helping our little economy. We need to make sure we are doing all the right things to preserve these areas where we ride so we can continue to do what we love and continue to support the community. Lastly, why is my topic important to the ecosystem? Like I stated before, part of the reason I love mountain biking so much is because I get to spend time in nature. And this can be said for almost everyone involved in the sport. We want to uphold the surroundings so they remain as beautiful as they always have been. Now to address the issues. According to Joshua Callahan, in his thesis, Erosion and Trail Building, all the effects or issues associated with trail systems can be split into two groups, the first being the loss of vegetation. Of course, with a beaten traveled path comes the loss of plants that hold the soil and slow erosion. The loss of vegetation is the more broad of the two groups. It consists of habitation loss, trail widening, root damage, soil erosion, and degraded aesthetics. The second of the two, water interception, consists of redirected water, drought, sedimentation, and puddling. Moving on, the solutions to these problems. I had the opportunity to interview local pro and lead trail builder at the newly developing SVR bike park, Frank Kulno, to talk about how they attempt to limit erosion on the trails. He said, not only do we not want to alter the natural erosion process, but we put countless hours into our trails and don't want them to wash away. Frank says planning for runoff is one of the first steps in the trail building process. We begin by studying topographical maps and see how the water behaves during which times of the year. Once this is done, we try our best to plan the trail around these areas. If we are not able to build around these areas, we make ways for the water to work around the trail. Frank explained to me that this is done by digging under the trail and laying down rocks or piping to filter water through, building bridges, or my favorite of Frank's solutions, jumping these areas. No matter how hard we try, some of these areas will still see runoff. So how do we slow the erosion? The United States Department of Agriculture states lining the trail with rocks or logs catches loose material that might otherwise end up in rivers. They also say that building trails on more coarse surfaces or covering trails with gravel helps prevent the acceleration of the process. Another solution to limit erosion on the trails is by building raised trails. As you see in the picture to the right, trails can be built up off the ground to avoid wet areas and reduce the impact of erosion. Finally, my conclusions. Accelerated erosion. After studying for my project, I found that mountain biking does indeed accelerate the erosion process, but there are multiple ways to slow this erosion process, bringing us to the solutions. As you saw in the solutions that I described, there are multiple things that can be done to slow or prevent the effects of erosion. There's also benefits to these trails that help more than just humans. Animals can use these trails as an easy way to get around. And these are my sources. I'm Tegan Golaid, and thank you for listening.
So, well done, Tegan. Here are the top three projects for Lakeland High School. We had first place, Caleb Brokaw and Nolan Nygaard, the effect of de-icer on groundwater and surface water. In second place, Emily Eisenberger and Ashley Morgan with drinking water quality. And in third place, Wyatt Liebrandt, Richard Thomas, and Alden Waddington with groundwater and contaminants. So again, we will show the top project from Lakeland High School. We don't have enough time today to show all of the projects, but certainly if there's something that catches your eye and you're interested in, we can send you the link. So you can get in touch with me if you have any questions about that. and several of these will be highlighted on our website. Here is the first place project from Lakeland High School.
I'm Nolan Nygaard.
And I'm Caleb Brokaw, and we did our project on the effect of de-icer on groundwater and surface water. So our hypothesis is if there is a significant use of de-icer in the region, then the chemical makeup of groundwater and drinking water will be negatively affected because de-icer is made up of chemicals like magnesium chloride and sodium chloride. So our research question is, what are the effects of de-icer on groundwater and surface water? So we chose de-icer as a topic because it's important to talk about because it affects everybody, especially in northern Idaho. The prominence of de-icer is a crucial issue and can cause many problems that normally people don't link to de-icer. And when we were going through our creative process, we knew we wanted to do a topic on pollution, and de-icer seemed to be a good topic because we were both uninformed on it, and the Confluence members were excited to see us talk about it.
After we decided that the effects of de-icer on groundwater would be our project, we knew that we needed to do our research and collect data. This is why we reached out to Jenny Gray from the Panhandle Health District. She gave us a link to a website that shows dozens of wells and the testing that they have done for them. It also shows the amount of everything that they tested for. This is a graph of the amount of magnesium in the Rathdrum Grange well from 2003 to 2021. As you can see, there is a clear increase of the amount, more specifically from late 2014 to the present time. Correlating along with this, this is a graph of the amount of chloride in the same well. As you can see, there is less of a increase or spike, but there is a positive trend line in the amount of chloride. Moving on, the reason we included a graph of the populations of Coeur d'Alene, Hayden, Post Falls, and Liberty Lake is because the rising infrastructure and population could have an impact on the amount of de-icer used. With all of this new infrastructure, it could cause the city to have to use more amounts of de-icer, or if they have to build new major roads to help with the flow of traffic and increase of traffic, they could also require de-icer every season.
So the effects of de-icer use have on the environment. There is an increased erosion of cars and metal through sodium chloride. It's toxic to plants and animals that are potentially exposed. It alters water for aquatic life, like fish and aquatic insects. It changes the soil and ability to sustain life. It infiltrates groundwater and in turn drinking water, runs off to lakes and rivers, and can break down concrete and asphalt. So this slide shows some of the impacts of de-icer runoff. So one of the impacts is the salty remains on the roadway gets dried up, and they can get carried away by the wind, and that can impact vegetation, soil, and water. And another impact is from de-icer that has been either plowed, sprayed, or drained to the roadside as a liquid, and that can drain into surface water, and it can percolate through the soil, and that impacts water, stream flora, and stream fauna. And contact with vegetation can be toxic to it, and that impacts vegetation. It can also percolate into drained soils and transport it to groundwater, which really impacts lakes and rivers and vegetation too. And it can also percolate into slow drained soils, and that can accumulate salt in the upper level, and it impacts soil structure, vegetation, and erosion.
There are several ways you can decrease the amount of de-icer used on a larger commercial level and a smaller personal level. The first one being obvious is to use less de-icer overall and prepare for the conditions. whether this means laying a tarp down beforehand or whatever you may have to do. The second one goes with the first one, and that is to avoid excessive use of de-icer. Only use the amount recommended or what you may think you need. On a larger scale, such as for the city, they could potentially try calcium magnesium acetate. This is the least toxic of de-icers out there and the best for the environment. The next two, remove as much as possible by hand and apply small amounts before the storm or weather, go hand in hand. Applying small amounts beforehand is the best way to reduce the amount of ice that forms. And removing as much possible by hand decreases the total amount of de-icer that you have to use because it decreases the amount of snow and ice. The last one, trying homemade de-icers, is perfect for smaller scale, such as at your home or business. If you go online and look up homemade de-icers, there are several examples of solutions and mixes that you can use that work for de-icer. Caleb and I were able to get in contact and have a verbal interview with Todd Fuger, the director of the Street and Engineering Department of Coeur d'Alene, Idaho. We asked him a few questions, and this is the information that we got. A low-end amount used would be around 30,000 gallons a season. This clearly depends on the temperature and moisture content of the snow and ice. They personally use sodium chloride, sometimes with a compound called Boost, which is a byproduct of sugar beets. This just helps it stick to the road and catalyzes the effects better. They personally do all the manufacturing, and they wash the rocks clean until 23.3% salinity, and that is when they are ready to load it into the trucks and distribute it. He also told us the ratio that they use, which is 3.23 pounds of salt rock per gallon of water. This is the dilution that they prefer and works best for them. They also use monitoring stations in the stormwater areas to make sure that the environmental impact is as low as possible. Being able to keep track of this is very important to Todd and the department. This way they can tweak whatever they're doing in case it is impacting the environment too much.
So great. Thank you, Nolan and Caleb. On to Lake City High School. So again, these are based on the rubrics. We had three, the first place, second place, and third place from Lake City. First place was William Myers, Kristen Lundy, and Tyler Hurst with Stormwater Science. In second place, Lucy Mendez, Palmer Rakes, and Randall Gass, the effect of stormwater drain pollution on Lake Coeur d'Alene. And in third place, Austin Stroman, Jaden Troll, and Luke Wingant. How do different types of fertilizer affect algae in Fernand Lake? So we will show the top placing project from Lake City.
The background information for our group's Confluence Project is that the Spokane Valley Rathdrum Prairie Aquifer holds the water we use and the water that flows in and out of our rivers and lakes. Underground, the main layer of our aquifer is the substrate, quote, that contains and transmits groundwater, unquote, and filters water as it passes through. For the purpose of this experiment, we're using the very same materials found in our substrate, quote, sand, gravel, cobbles, and boulders, unquote. Our research question and our entire Confluence project hinges on stormwater pollutants to our aquifer. You may ask, what are stormwater pollutants? Well, they're the things that get carried away by water after a storm event, like, quote, trash, chemicals, oil, and sediment, unquote. Our experiment's three stormwater pollutants are pool chemicals, safe degreaser cleaner, and antifreeze. The metrics for determining the water quality of each polluted water sample will be their bromine, total alkalinity, and pH levels compared to the levels in tap water.
We chose our topic to see how effective our aquifer could filter the harmful stuff that's in the water.
Our research question is, which stormwater pollutants affecting the Spokane Valley Rathdrum Prairie Aquifer is best filtered for water quality, bromine, total alkalinity, and pH, through the aquifer substrate. Our hypothesis is based on the fact that we use pool chemicals for swimming pools, so the water will be cleaner than the other chemicals that we used. So our problem is the potential damage to our aquifer by stormwater pollutants. Our solution is to prevent pollutants from entering the surface water and by extension our aquifer by using less of the most dangerous chemicals. We also want to practice better disposal and install better treatment for stormwater runoff.
Our first step into doing our experiment, we had to cut our bottles, and when cutting the bottles, we had to place the top actually inside the bottom, so it was an easier filter for us to use. Our second step to doing this, we had to put the gravel inside the top of the bottle that we cut. We had to fill that up, and then we poured water into it so it would drain into the bottom. For step three, we tested the water that was filtered through the gravel, as you can see right here. We filtered it and to act as our control. For step four, we poured the chemicals into the gravel so it would go into the, it would also filter through into the water. And when we do that, we now will be able to test it. For our final step, we tested our filtered chemicals to the control.
Okay. So, after we cut these water bottles up, each one is 1.5 liters, we put in the substrate material over here that was donated to us by Mr. Essler that represents the type of material that's found in our aquifer. We poured in tap water into each one, let it drain down a bit and gather in the collection parts, and now we are going to start actually putting chlorine in each one of them and testing them.
Completing our experiment, our analysis from the data showed that our outliers included the safe degreaser pH that was the highest recorded at 9. The pool cleaner had the lowest alkalinity at only 10 parts per million. Problems with data collection included the ratio of water and pollutant material that could have varied between filtered samples. Trends included the bromine of every sample that was at 0, except for the pool cleaner, in which it was 10 parts per million, as expected. All three stormwater pollutants had higher pH levels than the tap water sample. Overall analysis of the data shows that bromine stays the same after going through the filter, but alkalinity decreases in all of them after being filtered, and pH decreases in all but the safe degreaser, where it stayed the same. This proves that our substrate at least filters some alkalinity and some phosphorus and can be relied upon to get that out of our water.
So those were the top projects based on rubrics that the volunteer judges filled out, but our Confluence Project committee had some awards that we wanted to give out as well. So we had a couple different categories. The first was most unique research question, and the two winners for that were Tegan with mountain biking and erosion, which we already saw, and Naomi Booth, Reese Ramsrud, and Liz Morris from Lake City High School, for their project on the effect of microplastics on beaches. Naomi, Reese, and Liz's video was quite long and we don't have time to show it today, but as I said, we will be highlighting several of these on our website, and if anybody would like to watch it, please get in touch with me. We're gonna go on to the next one, the TCP Committee Award for Most Creative Video. Again, we had two winners for this. We had Haley Coleman and Jordan Hodgkins from Lakeland High School. Their project was, how does algae affect the amount of oxygen in water? and then Lucy Mendez, Palmer Riggs, and Randall Gass from Lake City High School, the effect of stormwater drain pollution on Lake Coeur d'Alene. So again, we don't have time to show all the videos, but we will be showing this project, Lucy, Palmer, and Randall's.
The effect of stormwater drain pollution on Lake Coeur d'Alene.
I'm Lucy Mendez.
I'm Palmer Riggs.
And I'm Randall Gass.
Stormwater is collected in pipes and discharged into streams and other surface water sources. Additionally, stormwater is directed to swales and dry wells to be dispersed to the Spokane Valley Rathdrum Prairie Aquifer. Stormwater typically has high levels of metals from cars, salts, and other sources. Residue and waste is often left at the grades as an effect of this. Many of the storm drains in Coeur d'Alene flow directly to the lake and Spokane River without any treatment, transporting leaves and other debris. Research question. What effects do ground pollution around storm drains in Coeur d'Alene have on the pH levels, oxygen levels, and turbidity of the lake? Despite the lack of rain here in Coeur d'Alene this spring, pollutants such as pollen, trash, and sediment suspended in the stormwater harm the health of our lake. They lead to a change in the pH, a decrease in oxygen levels, and a decrease in turbidity.
Oh my, ladies and gentlemen, I have just received a very scary update. It appears as though we are in the midst of a drought here in beautiful Coeur d'Alene, Idaho. Now, although I have dressed for the occasion of rain for this overcast day, there's absolutely zero rain in the forecast. Now, unfortunately, the reason this is this has been the driest season since 1895, which the information was provided by one Mr. Randy Mann right there. Now, unfortunately, what this means for three local Lake City students, Randall Gass, Lucy Mendez, and Palmer Riggs, is that they had to simulate their rain using buckets of water and the Lake City driveway. Now, my name is Carl Zeus Jr. the third, and I am signing off from Lucy's front yard. Thank you very much.
Okay, so this is all of our data collection. We collected data from five different spots on the river and lake, and we also had an extra spot where we simulated rain in the Lake City parking lot. The oxygen levels stayed about the same throughout them, but there's two big outliers being the Hagedon Center, which had significantly more dissolved oxygen, and the second Spokane River spot, which had a significantly lower dissolved oxygen level than the rest of the spots. And for the pH levels, most of them stayed about the same. However, the Lake City simulation pH level was significantly higher than the other ones for the most part. The turbidity stayed about the same, very clear. However, at the city beach in the Lake City simulation, it dropped. Only not too much in the city beach one, but significantly at the Lake City simulation. The water temperature stayed about the same all the way across due to the fact that we recorded most of our data on the same day.
Yeah, drought time. We are in drought time. Look at this sample. We got it from Lake City. It didn't come from the rain, from the buckets we poured down the drain. Word. In our research, we were able to find that in our more polluted areas, such as the second Spokane River, the oxygen levels were lower. As results, as the pH levels not skewing from the average even in our simulation. As we mentioned in our hypothesis, the turbidity was going to be affected by our ground pollutants, which is shown very much in our Lake City simulation being so low due to pollen, sediment, and student-produced trash. The city beach data was also very low compared to other sites. Water temperatures stayed around the same due to the fact that we tested on the same days. We came up with a solution to this, being that more people aware by putting signs such as the no dumping flows to lake spray painted right next to storm drains. We walked around town finding the storm drains that led to the lake, and a lot of them didn't have this sign. We also wanted to share the importance of keeping our lake clean and teach and preach that our actions affect the land. As we can see in the picture, that's me. Big thank you to Jamie Esler for teaching us all about our watershed and helping us problem solve throughout our difficulties. Marie Schmidt for allowing us to use equipment and being able to test the water, and Kim Harrington for donating a map of the drains in CDA and helping us answer questions about our findings.
We had a TCP committee award for the most likely to have community impact, and our two winners for that were Austin, Jaden, and Luke from Lake City High School on how do different types of fertilizers affect algae in Fernand Lake, and Victoria Stamper, also from Lake City High School, on the Boys and Girls Club solution.
So here's our research question. How do the different types of grass fertilizer affect the free-floating algae in Fernand Lake? So we're going to be testing inorganic, also known as synthetic fertilizer, and then we're going to be testing organic fertilizer. Right here we have a picture of Fernand Lake, and you can just see the amount of algae that is growing on the sides. So how do we choose our topic? Well, we chose it by brainstorming some recreational activities that we like to enjoy in our watershed, such as fishing, boating, and swimming. And how can they get interrupted or halted completely due to the growth of algae blooms in the lake? We explore types of different pollutants in the watershed, and we saw the pollutant fertilizer, so we chose the topic in relation to grass because most people use grass fertilizer rather than farming fertilizer, which is the latter. Here's our hypothesis. Our hypothesis is that the synthetic fertilizer is going to increase the population of algae more than the organic fertilizer. We think this because organic fertilizer is more applicable when it's used on plants that are buried, because it provides nutrients to the soil and roots, and because algae isn't buried in dirt, we think it will grow bigger with the inorganic fertilizer. Lastly, synthetic and inorganic fertilizer is known to have a higher concentration of NPK, which should cause algae growth to speed up. Here we have a fact from Indians' Clear Choice Clean Water. When too much fertilizer enters the water, it can cause the natural process of eutrophication to speed up. Eutrophication causes algae growth to explode.
This is our online research. The types of lawn fertilizers and their differences. Inorganic and synthetic fertilizer is fast-acting due to its higher levels of nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium levels, also known as NPK, which feeds plants a higher concentration of micronutrients. Organic fertilizer has a lower NPK analysis than synthetic fertilizer. However, organic fertilizer had the micronutrients that plants need, unlike inorganic fertilizers. Organic fertilizer feeds plants for a longer period of time. The importance of the NPK value of grass fertilizer that we will test. The NPK value of fertilizer are the three macronutrients used by plants, nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. The higher the NPK value of the fertilizer, the more concentrated the nutrients are. For example, an NPK value of 555 means that the fertilizer contains 5% nitrogen, 5% phosphorus, and 5% potassium. This is also shown on the graph to the right. For our experiment, this is how we'll conduct it. Using green algae floating in the Fernand Lake, we will put portions of algae in 6 separate containers with the lid off underneath UV lights, each having a different variation of fertilizer, whether mixed or unmixed. Making sure they are identical in size, we put an amount of grass fertilizer in the containers. Wait a week and monitor the results using scales to measure the weight of only the algae and not the water or container when it was held in. To the right is a picture of the algae and stuff. How we will conduct our experiment part 2. We're going to weigh all the algae jars on Friday and Monday just before school to figure out how many grams each weighs when we just start 3 days later and 3 more days later. Using this info, we should be able to determine which fertilizer causes the algae to grow the most in grams.
Okay, so here's our data. So the control, we have 2.9 grams of growth. Unstored organic, we have 2.3 grams of growth. Stored organic, we have 1.7 grams of growth. Unstored synthetic, we have 2.1 grams of growth. And stored synthetic, we have 3.1 grams of growth. Our potential solution. Our solution to this is everyone should switch to organic fertilizer instead of using the synthetic variation. Our evidence to back this up is organic fertilizers have a lower NPK than synthetic, which means that organic is more healthy for the environment. As stated in slide 9, the higher the NPK value, the more concentrated the macronutrients in the fertilizer are. And the more concentrated the macronutrients, the more potent the fertilizer, and the more harmful it is in large quantities. Our concluding statements. How can we conduct this experiment differently or get more accurate data? We can get the same amount of algae in water to make it even more accurate. We can leave the algae outside instead of under UV lights. We can use the same jar size and weight. We can mix it differently, like a current of a river. And we can also subtract the jar weight and water algae weight from each other so we get an exact measurement.
Well, next up, we have our second video that was most voted most likely to have community impact. This is from Victoria from Lake City High School.
Blue algae, forest fires, waste. You have to wonder how we can help the future CDA. Luckily, we have programs like OSP to educate students about the environmental issues in their community to help create future environmental heroes. But what is OSP?
My name is Jamie Essler. I teach environmental science at Lake City High School. Our goal is to get students to connect with our community and develop a sense of place so that they find their niche in Coeur d'Alene, and they can see connections between Coeur d'Alene's environment, Coeur d'Alene's culture, and Coeur d'Alene's history, so that they can better understand their individual place in our community. The Coeur d'Alene community is growing very, very fast. We have one of the fastest population growth rates in the state, which is one of the fastest growing population rates in the country. And whether we realize it or not, we are all connected to the way that we use natural resources, including water, open space, timber for construction, and it helps our students connect with their use of natural resources in our community. The funding of public schools at our state level is one of per student. The funding per student from our state funding is one of the lowest in the country. And that poses an increased burden on local taxpayers to make up for that difference or gap in funding. And to do that, we have to run as a community what are called supplemental levies. In OSP, all of our funding comes from either grant writing, community donations, or help from the state to cover the cost of field trips, particularly the cost of transportation and bus drivers.
The problem is not all schools can afford to have programs like OSP. In fact, poverty is our biggest challenge in educating students about the environment. According to the graph, it shows that students in low-funded schools often had lower scores when testing. Solution?
Ryan Yetnak. I'm the branch director. Our mission is to enable all young people, especially those who need us most, to reach their full potential as productive, caring, and responsible citizens. I think that one of the biggest things we do is we help kids, kind of figure out, gain a lot of self-confidence, grow in skills that they maybe didn't know that they had, make connections with peers and caring adults. I think in general, just feel better about themselves and have a sense of optimism that things aren't always what they appear, that things, if things aren't going well, that they're not always going to stay that way, and that there are people who care in this world. A lot of the programs we run, kids gain academic skills. I mean, even your science club, they're gaining some kind of academic achievement out of that. It's just not always traditional sitting down, reading a book, and doing problems, but learning through play. I run a program called The Ultimate Journey, which is an environmental awareness club, which teaches kids about recycling, just taking care of, like a big emphasis is taking care of parks. 2019, we went out to Tubbs Hill and picked up trash on Tubbs Hill, which was really cool. And then I think we went to 7th Street Park and did some park care with the city department as well, which was really cool. So yes, we've done some community involvement and definitely focusing on the environment.
Experiment. I conducted an experiment at the Kootenai Club to see how successfully club members could perform an environmental program. The experiment was about the Coeur d'Alene aquifer and how easily it could be polluted. We built a little aquifer and put green fluid dye in as the pollutant.
It didn't really go to the water, but then when we put the pump in the box, for some reason, it moved the thing a little bit, like we did this. Which made more of the green stuff come this way, but then for some reason, when we put the pump on the thing, the water was even greener than it was before.
Mm.
It didn't really do a good job at filtering, for some reason.
We pumped it from the rocks. The water was clear, but then when we pumped it from the water was green, so
then
from
Rodriguez
the rocks, the
go
water
Rodriguez.
Didn't, the green didn't come to the rocks, so the water was clear, but the water was still got to the rocks.
Because when we opened the water, it went clear, but then when we put the dye, we put it here instead of back here, so the water didn't get to there, it only stayed here.
Yeah. Great. Do you want to say hello?
So in conclusion, the experiment was a success. According to a study conducted by the University of Nebraska, they gave surveys to 3 elementary schools comparing the environmental awareness of the students. They found that the socioeconomic background affected how much knowledge is acquired about the environment in each school. But this success shows that the Boys and Girls Club could be the solution to find an affordable way to teach kids about the environment in the community. Like, for example, Coeur d'Alene, Idaho.
Go! Those were our videos most likely to have community impact. We also had 2 other videos that didn't fit into the categories that we had chosen, but we decided that they were honorable mentions. For best video production, we had Elizabeth Edmonds, Stephanie Katschmitter, and Joey Mabin from Lake City High School for their video Bitter Waters, which was documentary style film about Coeur d'Alene Lake. And then we had one that we nominated for the most math, which we didn't see that coming as a category, but these guys really did have pages and pages of equations that they had worked through. So that goes to Ethan Kirking, Sean Drimmon, and Andy Garofalo from Lake City High School on their project, Solar Powered Water Pumps. We would like to thank our sponsors for this program, the Aquifer Protection District, Avista Foundation, the Coeur d'Alene Tribe, and Alliance Data. We'd also like to thank the programs that donated some of the prizes for our top projects. So Lookout Pass Ski Resort, Silver Mountain Ski Resort, and Coeur d'Alene Resort for their Coeur d'Alene cruises. So thank you to all of those groups. Thank you so much to all of our students who put in videos. Again, we had 56 videos this year that we had submitted from students. So we really appreciate the students' hard work. We really appreciate the hard work of the teachers, and we appreciate the time of the volunteer judges who took their time to watch those videos and fill out the rubrics.